Good morning and welcome to the Cathedral Church of All Saints here in Halifax, Nova Scotia. If you're joining us online, you can find a copy of today's service on our Cathedral Church of All Saints website. Go to the Information tab, Bulletins and Newsletters. Also, under the Information tab, you will find information for Sunday school and some craft ideas there as well. Online, you can also find us Monday evening, 6:30 via Zoom for a series, Praying in Difficult Times. And last week began an Advent meditation series, Wednesdays at 6:30, also via Zoom. A brief teaching from one of four eminent Christian theologians and preachers. And this coming Thursday, will be Archbishop Rowan Williams, A Time of Expectation. Also join us online Monday through Friday for morning prayer. And we give thanks to our deacons and lay ministers for providing those services. Again, we meet here in person Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock. We do ask that you try and register on Eventbrite. Apparently there was some confusion with Eventbrite this week, but that does speed up the process of welcoming you into the church. So if possible, please use that service. If for some reason you can't, call the office, or if you show up, we will find a seat for you somewhere. Also, in person, we have worship on Wednesday morning, 7:30 in the morning here in the cathedral. Fridays at noon, a Book of Common Prayer Eucharist, and also Wednesdays in the Great Hall, an in-person meditation. Now, most Sunday evenings at 4 o'clock, we have an in-person service of evensong in one form or another. This Sunday, that service will be at King's College, 4 o'clock, with the chapel choir. And it's advisable you arrive early as seating there is limited. A special e-message was sent out last week and posted on our website with a number of Christmas outreach projects. If you have any questions, please contact Chris Field. That's chrfield@gmail.com. We're also looking for submissions for our news and announcements for the Advent Christmas Cornerstone newsletter. We need those by noon on December 7th. A reminder also, the missions to Seafarer shoeboxes were due back this past Friday, but if you have one, get it here quickly and we'll make sure it gets passed along. And finally, decorating some of the pews here this morning, you will find some red stockings, and those are for our sponsored refugee families. Take one, fill it, bring it back by the third Sunday of Advent. That is Rose or Pink Sunday or the Sunday of Joy, so that hopefully will be a reminder to you. As we gather this morning, although we have come together in person and in digital space, we each stand on ground that is the ancestral territory of peoples who were here long before the European settlers crossed the ocean. We gather here in and from the Cathedral Church of All Saints in Halifax, Nova Scotia, located on the unceded territory of the Mi'kmaq people. At this time, I'm going to share a message with any young folks that are here. So anyone that's in-house that wants to join us, just have a seat along the line there. And I'll also connect with folks online. So here's a question for you. What do you notice different in church this morning? Anything? Yep. The cloth is changed, and what color is it now? We've got blue on today, and that's because of a special season we're about to start? Yeah. What else do you see? Yeah. The poster is over there. Yeah. We have posters up that talk all about the things we do through the cathedral. Yeah. Something else? This thing right here. Absolutely. This thing right here is called our Advent wreath. And that's what I want to talk about this morning. This is, the reason we're in blue is we're starting the season of Advent. And Advent, have you ever heard the word adventure? And what is an adventure? That's right. An adventure is kind of when you go off and you do something new and you explore. And that, in a sense, is what Advent is about. Now, Advent uses a special symbol. Have a seat there. Advent uses a special symbol, which we call the Advent wreath. And what do you notice on the wreath? The wreath, first of all, is round. And I'm just going to hold something up for people on screen to see. This is a circle. And where, good to see you. Now, where does a circle begin and where does it end? It begins nowhere and it ends nowhere. You can't find the beginning and the end. And if you've ever had a roll of packing tape that's clear and you've tried to find the end, guarantee you, you'll know that a circle has no beginning and no end. So our wreath over here is round, to remind us that God has no beginning and no end, that all of life goes on forever. The other thing that's on it is, besides the circle, yep, there are candles, and there are 5 candles, one for each Sunday of Advent, and the one in the middle is for Christmas Eve or Christmas Day. So those are going to help us on our adventure or our journey to mark the Sundays until we get there. Circles are O's, that's right. Like if you were writing letters, a circle is an O. Now there's something else on there. There's candles. There is, do you know what this is called? It's a branch off a tree, but what kind of a tree? Don't have to be specific. Is it a what? A pointy tree. They are pointy. Most of these grow to a point, like a Christmas tree, yeah? That's right. The same kind of tree branch that you would see on a Christmas tree. These are called evergreens. And it means that most trees this time of year look like this, don't they? All the leaves fall off. And we're going to come back to that in a minute. All the leaves fall off this time of year, and they don't look very attractive. But an evergreen always stays green. And yet, its little leaves fall off all year long, but they keep replenishing themselves. So it's not that they never lose their green. It's that they recycle themselves. Every time a needle falls off, another one grows. And I'll pass this to you because the trees that lose their leaves, if you look real careful on the end of it, you can take that. Look real careful on the ends of those sticks and you'll see some little bulgy things. And those are buds. Because even though they've lost their leaves, they already know that spring is coming at the end of the winter and the new leaves will come back. So you can make one for yourself at home as a way of reminding yourself of Advent. Just take a piece of paper, any color piece of paper, fold it in half, cut it in half. You'll end up with a piece like this. You can put that into a circle and tape it. And I can find the end of this tape because it's on a dispenser. Make 4 of those, or 3 of those and a pink one. Maybe glue them to a paper plate. Take a yellow piece of paper and make a little flame shape that you can then tape inside. Oops. Being careful not to cut my microphone cord. You can glue that inside, and then every Sunday you can put a new flame on to mark the next Sunday in our Advent season. And you can keep that as a way of reminding you at home about this Advent adventure we are on. And the other thing to remember is, this is a way of reminding us that each Sunday we are closer to welcoming the baby Jesus who was born on Christmas. So that's a way for us to remember what this adventure, this season, this journey of Advent is all about. Thank you very much. Sunday school next. Our teachers are waiting by the doorway. So anyone that wants to join them, head that way. Now, the other thing that we do on Advent Sunday is light the Advent wreath. So I'm going to ask, we have some lighters. Yes, here they come. And you will find, again, in your bulletin today, the sentences for the lighting of the Advent wreath. You can go and stand at the wreath, and I'll pass you my microphone. Let me put my mask on first. Go ahead.
Helps if you can read. Week one is concerning hope. We have endured much these past few years and know that there is more to face before us. We don't know if we have the strength to withstand what might be around the next corner. And we wonder who will stand with us, who will have our back, who will occupy our corner.
Who is with us? That is what we begin to wonder these days. Who will light our way and chart our course? Who is on our side? Who will welcome us home again?
Home. The prophet Jeremiah speaks of a branch that will be raised. Jesus spoke of a son of man that will descend among us. Both point to hope. A hope that calls us home, our true home, where we're welcomed and loved and included, where there is justice and equality and peace.
It is time, this Advent season, time to come home. We light this candle as a sign of our hope, our strong hope, that there is a way to return home, to our home in Christ, and it starts with us. And it starts here, and it starts now. It is time to come home.
Fill our hope and guide us home.
Let us join now in the opening hymn, Sleepers Wake.
Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Collect prayer for this first Sunday in Advent, we pray together. God of unveiled truth, in times of darkened sun and waning moon, lift up our hearts and waken our love to announce the coming dawn of unexpected peace through Jesus Christ, the one who is to come. Amen. Let us hear now our scripture reading.
A reading from the book of the prophet Jeremiah. The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promise I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. In those days and at that time, I will cause a righteous branch to spring up for David, and he shall execute justice and righteousness in the land. In those days, Judah will be saved, and Jerusalem will live in safety. And this is the name by which it will be called. The Lord is our righteousness. The word of the Lord.
This morning's psalm are the first nine verses of Psalm 25, which we will read responsively as indicated in your bulletin. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be humiliated, nor let my enemies triumph over me. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are everlasting. Gracious and upright is the Lord, therefore he teaches sinners in his way. All the paths of the Lord are love and faithfulness to those who keep his covenant and his testimonies. God of compassion and love, forgive us our sins, relieve our misery, satisfy our longing, and fulfill all our hopes for peace. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Redeemer. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
There will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in a cloud with a power and great glory. Now when these things begin to take place, stand up and raise your heads, because your redemption is drawing near. Then he told them a parable. Look at the fig tree and all the trees. As soon as they sprout leaves, you can see for yourself and know that summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly, I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Be on guard so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man. The Gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be now and always acceptable in your sight, Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. We just heard Jesus say, there will be signs in the sun, the moon, and the stars, and on the earth distress among nations, confused by the roaring of the sea and the waves. People will faint from fear and foreboding of what is coming upon the world, for the powers of the heavens will be shaken. Now, I don't know about you, but that sounds eerily prophetic of our current experience for a text that was written 2,000 years ago. Yesterday, British Columbia and the northern U.S. Pacific coast were bracing for what meteorologists are calling an atmospheric river with as much as 120 millimeters of rain expected. In areas still trying to recover from torrential rains and mudslides a week earlier, and wildfires this summer. Here in the Maritimes, we felt the effects of a similar storm last week, with portions of roadways in New Brunswick, Cape Breton, and Newfoundland's southwest coast washed away, cutting off vital transportation links. And in the UK, northeastern England and Scotland were hit Friday night and yesterday by a storm named Arwen, which brought 98-mile-an-hour winds, rain, and snow. Meanwhile, on the prairies from Edmonton to Winnipeg, the most extreme drought conditions in 20 years have left grain farmers worried of low yields this season and fears about next year. And if we haven't weathered enough storms literally, word comes this week from the World Health Organization of a new COVID variant, Omicron, which has led to global travel restrictions as we face the reality that much of the world remains unvaccinated and the virus continues to morph. It all sounds, as I'm sure Jesus' message to his listeners back then did, pretty apocalyptic. Now, I realize one of the dangers of having services online is that at any moment you can say, I've had enough of this, and hit the search button for cute cat videos instead of listening to this doom and gloom. It's a little more conspicuous to leave if you're in-house. So hold on for a moment, don't leave just yet. Why are we reading passages of Scripture like this today? It's Advent, for heaven's sake. It's the beginning of the church's new year. We started this morning by lighting a candle for hope. And I guess the question would be, how hopeful are you feeling right now? This season of Advent, I think, brings with it enough tension of its own. We're called to slow down and prepare ourselves, while at the same time, everything seems to be speeding up. Black Friday, Cyber Monday, have you finished your shopping yet? It's the mental equivalent of driving with one foot on the gas and the other on the brake. Who has time to get ready? The Advent wreath itself can seem more like an unsettling countdown reminder of the dwindling Sundays left until Christmas. Another week, another candle, time is running out. So what is the message in all of this? There are days, and having just come off a week away, when hitting the snooze button on life and pulling the covers up over your head and staying in bed is very tempting. Don't tell me you haven't felt that way from time to time. I read a story in the Washington Post this week of a man named Billy Barr, who left his accounting career in New Jersey to move to a cabin 10,000 feet up, just below the summit of Gothic Mountain in the Colorado Rockies. Now, doesn't that sound intriguing? If you did nod your head knowingly during the gospel reading, thinking that Jesus could be describing our current world situation, know that for better or worse, the world has known more war and rumors of war and tumult than it has ever known times of sustained peace and prosperity. It doesn't justify it or make it right, I'm just saying. And living in a climate like this, it becomes hard indeed sometimes to see hope. I watched a new movie this week, not Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, but a movie in the genre of holiday films called A Boy Named Christmas. And it's based on a children's book by contemporary writer Matt Haig, who, along with a slew of children's books, has written several best-selling adult novels, such as The Midnight Library, How to Stop Time, The Humans. And while it is billed as a children's movie full of mystery and magic and a talking mouse and elves, it has a lot of adult overtones. Among the cast are Dame Maggie Smith and Jim Broadbent. Filmed on location in Finland, Lapland, and London, the cinematography is beautiful. It tells the story of an ancient kingdom that has fallen on hard times. And so in the opening scene, the king summons the people together to address them and challenge them to a quest. He says, "We all know times are hard. I mean, really, really, really hard. And I can't remember the last time I smiled, can you? What is there to smile about? We're all miserable. We're all missing something. And I think we all know what that is." And people in the crowd called out, "A better health care system? A living wage? A fair system of governance? Enough food to feed all the people?" The king looks a bit bewildered and says, "No, those are all good questions, though. I'll tell you what I think it is we are missing: hope. We all need hope, a spark of magic to keep us all going." And that is the quest the king puts before them, to go and search for and to bring back something of hope. It is curious what Jesus says this morning, even as he speaks of the harsh realities of this world and the caution that things may not get better anytime soon. For in concluding today's text, he says, "Now when these things begin to take place, stand up, raise up your heads, because your redemption is drawing near." Maybe despite all we see, maybe even because of all we see, there is still hope. Hope is echoed in those words of Jeremiah this morning. For Jeremiah can foresee a day when the people of Israel, held captive in a foreign land, will be set free, will return to their homeland. "The days are surely coming, says the Lord, when I will fulfill the promises I made to the house of Israel and the house of Judah. I will cause a righteous branch to spring up." Can there indeed be something to be hopeful for? Against this dark backdrop of Jesus' teaching, we light a candle of hope this morning. And part of our hope in doing so is that we are not just counting down the days until the end comes, but rather observing how week by week, the candles are adding more and more light to this season. Something is growing. Something does have the potential to be reborn in all of us. There is perhaps a reason for us to lift up our heads. It is ironic that despair and discouragement are often the very places where hope is born. Out of darkness comes the light. Author Kayla McClurg writes, "It is easier to notice what is breaking down than what is emerging. The earth in distress, this we notice. Nations confused and in turmoil, this we notice. People fainting from fear and foreboding of what is coming into the world, this we notice. We more often fail to see the tiny signs of renewal, like the way a community bands together after a storm or tragedy, small shoots of green rising up from the soil of loss. Look at the fig tree," Jesus says. But who notices something as common and plain as a fig tree? In the region where Jesus was teaching, the fig tree was the most ordinary of trees. Durable and hardy, with roots that run deep, it was known for producing fruit in even the most inhospitable of conditions. Jesus understands the fig tree, and he wants us to see and observe and learn a lesson from it as well. He knows what it takes to stand your ground, to thrive in not so easy conditions, to put one's roots down deep and draw nourishment from a hidden source. The signs are all around us, the breaking down that precedes the breaking through. Constant reports of violence and devastation, the increasing mayhem of distrust and fear. At the same time, see how compassion can sprout like leaves. 2 weeks ago, we highlighted the many outreach connections this community has in the wider community around us. Directly impacting lives through your efforts, food, clothing, support for agencies and services for those most vulnerable. A flickering light of hope. This week, a young woman, one day from her 28th birthday, was tragically struck and killed in a Dartmouth crosswalk. And a GoFundMe drive has collected in 2 days over $83,000 to bring Suti's parents to Canada from Hong Kong. No amount of money can change the reality. But it speaks to the humbling compassion that is rooted within each and every one of us. From the hard packed ground of our cynicism and fear and self-centeredness, shoots of hope can indeed spring forth. Billy Barr, the man from New Jersey that moved to an abandoned silver mine high up in the Rockies, that wasn't last week. That was over 50 years ago. He's now 71 and he is still there. But in his solitude, Billy Barr has every day for 50 years kept detailed diaries of the weather. He did it mainly to pass the time, but now his humble efforts in recording temperature, snow, rainfall, the movements of animals and changes in vegetation have become an invaluable record of climate change in real time, helping us better understand how we impact our planet and how to prepare for our future. Advent is an odd season. A time of both waiting and getting ready. But an old mantra that is a favorite of mine states, what you do while you're waiting depends on what you're waiting for. So ask yourselves, what are we waiting for? Part of the message of this Advent season is our yearly reminder that God does not give up on us. And we are called not to give up on God. The seeds of hope can split open even the hardest of hearts. I think that's what Jesus is trying to tell us today. Perhaps we can't change the hardships and tragedies that confront us in life, and they are many, and they are painfully real, but we can transform them. In Christ, all things can be made new. We can seek in this Advent season to grow in hope, in love, in joy, and to embrace peace. I want to close with a poem crafted by a woman whose birthday would be tomorrow. Madeleine Engel was born November 29th, 1918. This poem she writes with an Advent theme. It's a reminder that God breaks into our world and into our lives, not when all is calm and peaceful, not when our lives are totally together, but rather at those opportune moments when we do lose sight of hope, when the need is greatest. She calls her poem First Coming. He did not wait till the world was ready, till men and women and nations were at peace. He came when the heavens were unsteady and prisoners cried out for release. He did not wait for the perfect time. He came when the need was deep and great. He dined with sinners in all their grime, turned water into wine. He did not wait till hearts were pure. In joy, he came to a tarnished world of sin and doubt, to a world like ours, of anguish, shame, he came, and his light would not go out. He came to a world which did not mesh, to heal its tangles, shield its scorn. In the mystery of the Word made flesh, the Maker of the stars was born. We cannot wait till the world is sane to raise our songs with joyful voice. For to share our grief, to touch our pain, he came with love. Rejoice. Rejoice. Amen.
Let us confess the faith of our baptisms as we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of God and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
The litany today is the Advent litany, but there's no lead-in to the response, so I will try to raise my hand when it's time. In hopeful expectation, let us pray to our Savior and Redeemer, saying, Lord Jesus, come soon. In our diocesan cycle, we hold up the Episcopal Anglican Church of Brazil. We pray for Linda, our primate, David, our metropolitan, and Sandra, our bishop. We remember the parishes and clergy of Amherst and Parsborough Shore, and our associate parish of Falkland St. James. We pray for Paul, our rector and dean, Helen, our associate priest, Heather, Ray, and Maggie, our deacons, and all who worship here, lay and ordained. O wisdom from the mouth of the Most High, you reign over all things to the ends of the earth. Come and teach us how to live. Lord Jesus, come soon. O Lord and head of the house of Israel, you appeared to Moses in the fire of the burning bush, and you gave the law on Sinai. Come with outstretched arm and ransom us. Lord Jesus, come soon. O branch of Jesse, standing as a sign among the nations, all kings will keep silence before you, and all peoples will summon you to their aid. Come, set us free, and delay no more. Lord Jesus, come soon. We pray for the needs of the world, especially remembering the suffering and ongoing challenges caused by flood in British Columbia, in the Atlantic provinces. Give courage to your people who trust in your love. We pray for the ill and those in special need, holding up Patricia and Ed, Bob, Lily, David, Mary, Sharon, Latta, James and Cynthia, Douglas, Ian, Beverly, Megan, Peter, Russ, Lori, Bob, Anne, Raphael, Leslie, Heather, Andrew, Ayla, Kathy, Linda, Frank, Beverly, Paula, Charlie, Marilyn, Lorraine, Anne and family, Bev and family, Barry and Sandy. Shepherd them and give them the comfort of friendship and healing. O morning star, splendor of the light eternal and bright sun of righteousness, come and enlighten all who dwell in darkness and in the shadow of death. Lord Jesus, come soon. O King of the nations, you alone can fulfill our desires. Cornerstone, you make opposing nations one. Come and save the creatures you fashioned from clay. Lord Jesus, come soon. We hold up all those who have died. Gus Chisholm, Tony Bidwell, Suet Chan, Kristen Smith, and all the departed. Grace them with a share of your kingdom. O Emmanuel, hope of the nations and our Savior, come and save us. Lord Jesus, come soon.
Dear friends in Christ, God is steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. God welcomes sinners and invites us to this table. Let us confess our sins, confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon you. Pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the peace of the Lord be always with you. As we prepare the altar for Eucharist, we sing the hymn, How the World Longs.
Thank you.
Today we acknowledge wine and hosts given in memory of Patsy Swain from Margie and family, and in loving memory of Jamie Withrow from Margie and family. As we offer these gifts, and as we offer ourselves in loving service, and as agents of hope, may we pray together. God of love and power, your word stirs within us the expectation of the coming of your Son. Accept all we offer you this day, and sustain us with your promise of eternal life. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. We give you thanks and praise, Almighty God, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Redeemer. He is your living Word, through whom you have created all things. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh of the Virgin Mary and shared our human nature. He lived and died as one of us to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. In fulfillment of your will, he stretched out his hands in suffering to bring release to those who place their hope in you. And so he won for you a holy people. He chose to bear our griefs and sorrows and to give up his life on the cross, that he might shatter the chains of evil and death and banish the darkness of sin and despair. By his resurrection, he brings us into the light of your presence. Now, with all creation, we raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Let us pray. Holy and gracious God, accept our praise through your Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, who on the night he was handed over to suffering and death, took bread and gave you thanks, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body which is broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This is my blood, which is shed for you. When you do this, you do it in memory of me." Remembering, therefore, his death and resurrection, we offer you this bread and this cup, giving thanks that you have made us worthy to stand in your presence and serve you. We ask you to send your Holy Spirit upon the offering of your Holy Church. Gather into one all who share in these sacred mysteries, filling them with the Holy Spirit and confirming their faith in the truth, that together we may praise you and give you glory through your servant, Jesus Christ. All glory and honor are yours, Father and Son, with the Holy Spirit in the Holy Church, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. God of promise, you prepare a banquet for us in your kingdom. Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. These are the gifts of God for the people of God.
Thank you.
Let us pray. God, for whom we wait, you have fed us with the bread of eternal life. Keep us ever watchful, that we may be ready to stand before the Son of Man. We ask this in the name of Christ the Lord. Amen. Glory to God, whose power working in us can do infinitely more than we can ask or imagine. Glory to God from generation to generation, in the church and in Christ Jesus, forever and ever. Amen. Thank you for joining with us this morning, here and online, and may the week ahead be one of blessing for you. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of God's Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with you and those you love, this day and forever. Amen. Our closing hymn, Lo, He Comes with Clouds Descending.